Good evening, dearly beloved, or good morning, depending on which part of the world you're watching from. Welcome to the Divine Erudition. We thank the Lord for the opportunity He has granted us today to look at His Word on the subject of recreating your world. Hallelujah. And at this moment, I would like us to pray. I'm going to spend some time praying, thanking the Lord for this glorious moment. So wherever you are, let us pray. You can pray in the spirit or you can pray in the understanding. Let's pray. Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, we thank you and we honor you. O brage sovra gila kasombra gilo boshatamanda gila hosa prateses lemango rabibra kafaranigo songra dishka la manga deze lema hosha prantele bregida haska monga deze lebrekuja la bragila haso prateza la manga diska lemanda hasiataya. We thank you, precious Lord. We honor you. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for your love. Ligo boson de beredia. Ramo shikribrianda rabakorobosanda baradia. You are gracious and you are kind. And now our hearts and our minds are open to hear and receive your word, to be instructed, to be edified, to be built up. Thank you, blessed Father. We honor you. We worship you for this glorious opportunity you've granted us today. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Welcome once again to the Divine Erudition. The theme of our discussion today is recreating your world. Hallelujah. An interesting topic indeed. Recreating your world. Someone may ask, can you recreate your world? Exactly. But when you say recreating your world, what do we mean? What do we mean? Which world are we talking about? Which world are we talking about? We are talking about your world. Your world. You know, every man lives in his world. There is a world you live in. And when we talk about your world, we talk about your circumstances and the happenings of your life. What surrounds you, that is your world. So recreating your world is changing the circumstances of your life and the happenings around you. Taking your life from one level to another. You know, God desires that for your life. God desires that for your life. He says, remember not the former things, nor consider the things of old. See, I am doing a new thing. See, I am doing a new thing. So God wants to bring a change in your life, and He wants you to move from one level of glory to another, moving from grace to grace. Hallelujah. And so recreating your world is God's desire for you, so that you be all that God wants you to be. Hallelujah. And at this moment, I want us to look in the Word of God at a few portions of Scripture on this subject. So the first Scripture we're going to read is from the book of Hebrews, chapter 11. Hebrews chapter 11, and we're going to read from the verse 3. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 3 says that through faith we understand that the worlds were framed by the Word of God. So through faith we understand that the worlds were framed by the Word of God, so that the things which are seen were not made of things which do appear. And there are some beautiful things to look at in this portion of the Bible. It said, through faith we understand that the worlds were framed by the Word of God. Now the word translated worlds here is the word aeon. Now the word aeon means a period of time. It also means the successive ages. Or it also means the course of life. The course of life. The course of life. So when we talk about aeon, it means a period of time, the successive ages, a course of life. So your aeon is the course of your life, the direction of your life, that which happens in your life from day to day that affects even your aspirations and your goals. That is your aeon, the circumstances that surrounds you, your life and times. That is your aeon. What happens in your life in the succession of time, that is your world. He said that I want us to look at a scripture that really sets that in motion also. In Ephesians chapter 2, when we read Ephesians chapter 2 from the verse 1, it says, and you has he quickened, or you has he made alive, who were dead in trespasses and sins. Then it goes on to say, wherein in time past you walked according to the course of this world. The word translated course there is also the word aeon. So according to the aeon of this world, according to the course of this world. So the direction that this world is going, that is the aeon. That's also one of the translations for the word aeon. According to the course, the direction of this world. So what is your world or your aeon? Your aeon is the course of your life. The course of your life. The structure and the administration of your life. That is your aeon. What happens in your world? That is your yonder structure and administration of your life. How things go around you and how things work around you from day to day, including how they affect your hopes and your aspirations. That is your aeon. That is your world. And he says, through faith we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God. So the next word I want us to look at is the word framed. Framed. It is the word katatizo. Katatizo. Now, it is translated into different words in the Bible. It can be translated means to mend a net. You know, when fishermen go to fish and they come back, they mend their broken net, to mend your net. It can also mean to repair, katatizo means to repair. It also means to restore, hallelujah, to restore. And it also means to perfect or to make perfect. So the word framed used there, katatizo, means to mend, as in to mend something that is broken, to repair, to restore, or to make perfect. And he continues to say, through faith we understand that the worlds, the aeon, were framed, katatizo, by the word of God. By the word of God. So here, right away, he tells us what was used to frame the world. What was used to mend the world. What was used to make the world perfect. He says, it is the word of God. Oh, that's so inspiring. The word of God. The word of God. By the word of God. Now, the word translated word of God here is the word rhema. Rhema, because in the Bible, there are two words that I normally use when you make mention of the word of God. There is the logos of God and there is the rhema. Logos and rhema. Now, logos is the body of truth, the totality of truth, the body of truth. That communicates the purposes, the desires, the will of God for all the ages. You know, the body, the totality of truth. Then there is a rhema of God, which is the spoken word. The spoken word. The spoken word. The words that are that is being spoken forth. That is being spoken forth. The spoken word. The spoken word. I want us to look at a scripture. Something that Jesus said in the book of John. John chapter 6. In John chapter 6, Jesus says, it is the spirit that gives life. It is the spirit that gives life. And we're going to look at it. Now, Jesus says in John chapter 6, verse 63, he says, it is the spirit that gives life, or it is the spirit that quickeneth. Then he says, the flesh profiteth nothing. Then he goes on to say, the words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. Now, here also, the word translated, the words that I speak unto you, is the word rhema. So we can say this way, that it is the spirit that quickeneth, or it is the spirit that gives life. The flesh profited nothing. Then he said, the words, the rhema that I speak unto you, the rhema that I speak unto you, the words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. Hallelujah. And in Hebrews, we are told that the aeons were framed, they were mended, they were restored, they were made perfect by the rhema of God. So right away, we see the ingredients for change. We see what one requires for change. There is a God's way for change. There is a God's way to bring about change. And right away we see that it is by the word of God. By the word of God. So your faith and the word, your faith in the word, your faith in the word is what set in motion a change. Hallelujah. But before the circumstances on the outside can change, and before you can really have a lasting change on the outside, there's got to be a change on the inside. There's going to be a change on the inside. So what God really wants to change, or who God really wants to change, is you. Because when he changes you, he knows that you can change the circumstances of your life. And I want us to look at that one from Romans chapter 12. In Romans chapter 12, the Apostle Paul writes to the Romans, and he says in Romans chapter 12 verse 2, going to read that one, he says, and be not conformed to this world. Be not conformed to this world. That's so powerful. He says, don't be conformed to this world. Don't be conformed to this world and its way of doing things. Amazing, amazing. The word translated world here is the word also aeon. So don't be conformed to this aeon. Don't be conformed. Don't accept the status quo. Don't accept the course of things. You know, there was one time that some people came to Jesus with a question of divorce. And there was Jesus' response there communicates something very profound. They came to him with a question of divorce, and after all that they said, Jesus said in his response, he said that in the beginning it was not so. In the beginning it was not so. Meaning he took them back to the beginning, that this was the original intent. You know, sometimes there is so much deviation that people seem to lose track of what was the original intent, what was the original purpose of God. You know, when you have not lived or when you have not seen a particular life for long, it seems as though that life is impossible to even live. And you don't know, you don't have any picture in your mind of how that kind of life is possible. So they came to him with that question, and Jesus says, in the beginning it was not so. He took them to the beginning, the original intent, the original purpose of God. Hallelujah. So he said that do not be conformed to this aeon. In Romans chapter 12 verse 2, do not be conformed to this aeon. Then he goes on to say, be transformed, be transformed. He tells you what not to do, and he tells you what to do so that you can get his kind of result. So be not conformed to this world. That's number one. Don't be conformed to this aeon. Don't follow the course and the direction of this aeon, of this age. Then he says, but rather be transformed. Be transformed. And he tells you how to be transformed. Now, this transformation is a transformation of you, a transformation on your inside. He says, be transformed. Be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Renewing of your mind, meaning exchanging your thoughts for his thoughts, exchanging your ideas for his ideas, exchanging your perception, your way of your outlook on life for his outlook on life. You know, in Jeremiah said, I know the thoughts that I think towards you. They are not thoughts of evil, but they are thoughts to give you a future and to bring you to an expected end. So there is a way God thinks about you. And in renewing your mind means you are exchanging your thoughts for his thoughts, receiving his thoughts, dumping your own thoughts and receiving his thoughts. He said, when that happens, you will be transformed. You will be changed. You will be changed. And when that change happens, he said that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. That you may prove what is that good, acceptable, and perfect will of God. Now, what is the word? The word used there, prove, is an interesting word. Prove. It means to scrutinize. To scrutinize. Let's look at this example. When you're traveling into a country and you get to customs, they pass your bags through. The machine is to look at, trying to have a look at the content of it. There are some places that they will even open your bags and do a physical inspection. And what are they doing? They are scrutinizing your goods. Now, if they find anything that is not allowed by the law of that country, not allowed into that country, or not allowed by international regulations of travel, what would they do? They take it out of your bag and they dump it. It doesn't matter how much it costs. They are not going to allow that into their country. Why? They are scrutinizing your goods and seeing what things are allowed and what things are not allowed. And here God says the same thing, that when you are transformed, when your mind is renewed, you have the capacity to be able to scrutinize everything that is coming into your life. You scrutinize it to know, you know, in accordance with the law or with the word of God, in accordance with what God has dictated that should happen, what God desires for your life, that desire of God as expressed in his word. So you have a script to look at. That's what we call the scripture. You have a script to look at. You have something to look at. So in accordance with that script, does this fall in line? Does this conform with the will of God for my life? You have something to look at. Then by that, you can be able to now scrutinize everything coming into your life, every thought coming into your life, everything that wants to happen in your life. You can be able to scrutinize it. Then he said that you can be able to scrutinize it so that you only allow the good, the acceptable and perfect will of God. So meaning you'll be able to scrutinize and only allow the will of God in your life. Any transaction that is not of God, you're going to refuse it in your life. Why? Because with a renewed mind, you know the will of God. You know the will of God. You know, that was the prayer that the apostle prayed for the Philippians. I pray that you may be filled with the knowledge of his will. You may be replete with the knowledge of His will, filled with the knowledge of His will. You know the will of God. So when something is trying to come into your life, you know that this is not in the script. This is not allowed in my life by the law of God, by the word of God. So you can be able to scrutinize and reject those illegal transactions and contrabands from coming into your life. So you see how important the transformation on the inside is, so much important. They said that you be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you have the ability to prove. Then you have the capacity to really scrutinize things. Then you will know what to allow in your life and what not to allow. Hallelujah. You'll be able to know the good, acceptable, and perfect will of God. And even it is in degrees, there is the good, the acceptable, then there's the perfect, the best. The best of God's will for your life. Hallelujah. But it all, first of all, starts by you renewing your mind. You know, when you go born again, your spirit gets changed instantly. In that instant, just at the speed of thoughts, as you proclaim those words, I believe in my heart that Jesus is Lord, and I confess Him as Lord of my life. I receive by faith eternal life into my heart. At that moment, your spirit is changed, but your mind remains the same. You know, man is a spirit. He has a soul and he lives in the body. And the mind, the soul comprised of his mind, his emotions, the seat of his emotions and all that. And so your soul remains the same soul. So when it says the renewing of your mind, meaning that your mind has to be renewed so that it can come in alignment with your spirit, so that you can really experience that beauty of God that has come on your inside. Hallelujah. So to be able to really change your external circumstances, there have to be a change on the inside first. It's only a transformed man that can transform his world. It's only a changed man that can change his world. When you get better, things will get better. When you change, things will change. Hallelujah. So God wants the change to begin with you. With you. Hallelujah. So going back to Hebrews chapter 11 verse 3, it says, through faith we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God. By the word of God. So they were framed by the word of God. The rhema of God. The spoken word of God. The spoken word of God. And we see that same example in Genesis chapter 1. In Genesis chapter 1, from reading from verse 1 to verse 3, it says, in the beginning God created the heaven and the earth. Then the verse 2 says, and the earth was without form and void. That's quite interesting. It's obvious that something might have happened, because in the beginning God created the heaven and the earth. Then He says, and the earth was without void and without form and void. God didn't create a world that was without form and void. Something has happened and He was going to do something about it. And He said, darkness was upon the face of the deep. And He says, and the Spirit of God moved over the face of the waters. He was brooding over the face of the waters, brooding over the face of the waters, brooding over the face of the waters, and forming the picture of the change He desires. He was forming that picture, brooding over the face of the waters. And He says, and God said, let there be light, and there was light. You know, the original translation puts that light be. You know, the apostle tells us, God who commanded light out of darkness has shined in our hearts to give us light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. Said God who commanded light out of darkness. You know, so that change is going to come right from that situation. He said light was commanded out of darkness. It didn't come from somewhere. It was God commanded light out of darkness. But first of all, the Spirit of God was brooding over the waters. You know, brooding over the waters. And afterwards, God spoke. So we can follow God's example. And that's exactly what we are told in Ephesians chapter 5. In Ephesians chapter 5 verse 1, we are told that we should be imitators of God as dearly beloved children. Let's read that one. That's so beautiful. Ephesians chapter 5 from the verse 1. We are told to be imitators of God, to copy God. So what does the scripture say here? It says, from the Amplified translation, it says, therefore, be imitators of God. Copy Him and follow His example. Copy Him and follow His example. As well-beloved children imitate their father. Oh, he's our Heavenly Father. And the scripture calls on us here to imitate our Heavenly Father. Imitate our Heavenly Father. Imitate our Heavenly Father. So we are told to copy God, to follow his example. So in the creation, when things went bad, how did God bring about a change? He, first of all, the Spirit of God was brooding over the waters, brooding over the waters, you know, brooding over the waters. That is where your imaginative power comes in here, meditating on the Word of God. As you meditate on God's Word, as you set your mind on the Word of God, think through the Word, mutter the Word, roar in the Word. As you meditate on the Word, there is a picture that is forming on your inside. You know, the Scripture is actually full of pictures. The Bible is actually full of pictures, a lot of images. Which God shows you. God shows you a lot of images of the kind of person he wants you to be, the kind of life he wants you to be. Just like how he helped the vision of Abraham by bringing him out and saying, look at the stars, count them. If you can be able to count them, so shall your seed be. By the time Abraham counted to a certain degree and he could not count any longer, he understood that what God wanted to give him was really big. And he says, Abraham believed. You are not speaking so that you believe. You speak because you believe. You know, he said rhema means spoken words, but you speak because you believe. And that's what the scripture tells us. It said that we all having the same spirit of faith according as it is written. Then he says, I believed, therefore have I spoken. I believe, therefore have I spoken. Then he said, we also believe and therefore speak. So you see, the progression is that he says, first of all, I believed. He said, I believed, therefore have I spoken. I believe, therefore have I spoken. We also believe and therefore speak. So you first of all believe, then you speak. You speak your believing. You speak your believing. You speak your believing. And God says, I'm watching over my word to perform it. You speak your believing. So God's word is so powerful. And we see here that it was the word that God used to bring about a change. The spoken word. So he has given us his word. He has given us his word in writing. So we can take these words and meditate on them and have a picture formed on the inside. And that picture concerning any subject or any area of life, be it your health. You look in the Bible for scriptures that talks about healing and health. You meditate on them until you get a hold on your spirit. Then when it gets a hold on your spirit, that is when you start talking. Hallelujah. That is when you start talking. He said, I believed, therefore have I spoken. I believed, therefore have I spoken. I believed, therefore have I spoken. So when it gets a hold on your spirit, when you get a hold on it on the inside, then you start talking. Then the power of that word will be released. Remember, Jesus said, the words that I speak, they are spirit and they are life. And so just like Jesus, we can also say, the words that I speak, they are spirit and they are life. So actually, he used the word rhema there. He said, rhema is spirit and life. Hallelujah. It can bring life to death situations. Lago sefreniga haskas. It can bring life to death situations. So rhema is spirit and life. Rhema is spirit and life. But it first of all has to get a hold on your inside. If first of all that picture has to be formed on your inside, then you begin to voice your belief. You begin to voice your belief. So what should be our approach to the Word of God? What should be our approach to the Word of God? What should be our approach? What should be our response to the Word of God? What should be our response to the Word of God? Let's look at an example in Hebrews chapter 11. But we're going to read from the verse 13. Hebrews chapter 11 verse 13 say that these all died in faith, not having received the promises, but having seen them afar off and were persuaded of them and embraced them and confessed. Look at the progression. It said that they saw the promises afar off. You know, that's what I said, your imaginative ability is your creative ability. They saw the promises. They formed the picture. They could imagine it. What God was telling them, they could imagine it. He said that they saw them afar off and they were persuaded of what they were seeing. Oh, Masih and the Hesea. They were persuaded of them. Just like Abraham said that, who are against hope believed in hope. And he said that he staggered not at the promise of God through unbelief, but was fully persuaded that what God has said he was able also to perform. You know, God showed him a lot of pictures. What God told him, he could see the image of it. He could see the image of it. And without even having the children, he started calling himself the father of many. He started calling himself the father of many. So they saw it afar off and they allowed themselves to be persuaded of it. They allowed themselves to be. They were persuaded of those things that God told them. And they embraced them. They embraced that thing. They embraced that word. They embraced it. They saw it. They were persuaded of it. They embraced it. And the final thing is that they confessed. They spoke. They spoke. They spoke their believing. They spoke their conviction. They spoke what they were persuaded of. They spoke what they were persuaded of. So he said that we also have in the same spirit of faith, according as it is written, as in 2 Corinthians chapter 4. He said that I believe, therefore have I spoken, we also believe and therefore speak. So when you believe, then you speak your believing. You speak your believing. And that's where the power, the life is in the words that you speak. The words that you speak, because they are not your words. You are not just speaking any words. They are not positive talking. No, you are speaking the very words of God. The very words of God. You put the word of God in your mouth and you are speaking it forth. And God says, I am watching over my word to perform it. I am watching over my word to perform it. You know, God has said it. So when you also say it, you are agreeing with God. You are agreeing with God. And the power of God is released. You know, the Bible says in Amos, who shall come to work together except they be agreed. And as I said, who has believed our report, and to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? Meaning that the one who believed our report, they are the one that saw the power, the arm of God revealed on their behalf. The arm of God is the power of God. They saw the power of God revealed on their behalf. Why? Because God's power is a dynamic power that causes change. You know, in Acts chapter 1 verse 8, Jesus said, but you shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you. He said the Holy Ghost is going to bring you power. And that power is dunamis. Dunamis, it is inherent power. You know, the power for change, God put it where you can easily find it. He put it right inside you. When you receive the Holy Ghost, He put it right inside you. You know, in Ephesians, Apostle Paul said, unto him that is able to do exceeding abundantly abundant all that we can ask or think, according to the power that worketh, not in heaven, but in us. The power that worketh in us. So God's power for change, He put it, He deposited it right inside you. Inherent power. And it is a dynamic power to cause changes. And He put it right inside you. So when you have, when the change has begun on your inside, when you have taken in the word and your mind is being renewed and you are inundating your spirit and your mind with the word of God, then a picture is forming on the inside. Then you can really know what God desires for your life. Then you can prove. Then you know what to allow and what to disallow in your life. Then you are ready to really speak. You are ready to really speak. To speak your believing. To speak your believing. And that is Rhema. When you start speaking your believing. When you start speaking, you're believing. And as you speak those words, they are spirit and they are life. They are spirit and they are life. They are spirit and they are life. Meaning you can speak spirit and life to their situations in your life. As you voice out, give voice to the word of God. You know, because it is a waste of spiritual energy to talk about what is already there. What is already happening is already happening. What the circumstance is already there. So to talk about it or to use your words to affirm them again is a waste of spiritual energy. Knowing that you can use those same words to change what the status quo, you can use those same words to change what is happening, then it's a waste of spiritual energy to talk about the situation. When you know that you can be using those same words to talk about the change you desire to see. So you don't say what is, but you say what you want to see. Because that's exactly what he says in Hebrews chapter 11 verse 3. He said that through faith we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that the things which are seen were not made of things which do appear. The things which do appear are not the things that give birth to the things that are seen. But something, he said, the word of God, the rhema of God, the rhema of God, the rhema of God, the rhema of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, the rhema of God. So you need the word. You need the word for change. You need the word for change. And as you meditate on the word, you ponder on the word. You ponder on the word. It gets to a level where it gets a hold of your spirit and you start talking. And you start talking, and just like God, you begin to release life. You begin to release the power of God is released as you speak those words, and He makes it good. He confirms the word. He affirms the word, and you see that a change happens. A change happens, and it happens spiritually, and it shows up in your life. It shows up in your life. because this world we live in, the physical world, was bettered by the spiritual. So the spiritual controls this realm. And if you can change things from the realm that matters, things are going to change here. Hallelujah. So in recreating your world, you need the word of God. You need the word of God. You need the word of God. You need the word of God and the power of God's spirit. That's why it's so much important to receive the Holy Ghost. And if you speak in tongues, you as you pray in tongues, the spirit of God, that power is released on your inside. It's released on your inside for change. Hallelujah. 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 So let's just take a recap of a few things in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 3. Once again, it said, through faith, we understand that the aeons, the course of life, the successive ages, the life and times of a person. He said that they were framed, they were mended, they were mended, they were repaired, they were restored by the word of God, by the rhema of God. So that is it, by the rhema of God, by the rhema of God. You speak the word of God only. You see, the righteousness which is of faith, it doesn't, it speak the word. He said that what does that righteousness which is of faith speak? He said that the word is near you, in your mouth and in your heart. The word is near you. The word you need for that change is near you. He says it is in your mouth and in your heart. Speak the word. Don't waste that words on speaking about what already is happening. Use your words to create the thing you want to see. Call for things that be not as though they were. He said that he believed the God who calls the things that be not as though they were. That is our God. This is our God. Our God, our Father, calls things that be not as though they were. Because as he calls them forth, they do appear. Hallelujah. So as you call those things forth, they will appear. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. At this minute, I just wanted to thank God. Thank God for his word. Thank God for this understanding. And I know that as you are hearing, the Spirit of God is speaking to your heart. And in hearing, you will hear something specific for you. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Father, we thank you. We honor you. Thank you for your word. Thank you for the understanding of the scriptures you give us. Yes. Maroko sombra gila bakosha bragila masonte beredia. Rende bragila bakunga da sapratizianda. And this word is getting a hold of our spirit. We are progressively understanding, recognizing more strongly and clearly these truths, taking a hold of them. Yes. And walking in the light of them in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you, Lord, and we honor you in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Before we go, finally, just want to give you an opportunity. If you don't know the Lord Jesus as your Lord, you know, this is an opportunity for you. Today is the day he promised. Today is the day you are promised of. Never promise you tomorrow. So he says, today, if you hear his voice, harden not your heart. Today, if you hear his voice, harden not your heart. Harden not your heart. So if you have not known the Lord Jesus, and if you have not accepted him as Lord of your life, and you're not saved, you're not born again, you're not a child of God, today is a glorious opportunity for you to do so. Romans chapter 10 tells us that if you shall confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. So if you're not born again, pray this prayer with me. Dear Lord God, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. I believe that he died for my sins. And I believe that on the third day he rose again from the dead and is alive today. I confess with my mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord and Lord of my life from this day. I receive by faith eternal life into my heart and I declare that I am born again. Thank you, Jesus, for saving me. Amen. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God. Hallelujah. So if you pray that prayer, congratulations. You're born again. You're a child of God. And you can contact us on how to grow in the Christian faith. We love you and God bless you. Till we meet again, continue living in an atmosphere of miracles. Glory to God. How to